Hello and welcome to In the Huddle. I'm your host, JT Thomas, broadcasting live from the Green Turtle Sports Bar and Grill in Morgantown, West Virginia. Ladies and gentlemen, we just came off a road win from Landover, Maryland. We had the Mountaineer play BYU. But let me start off by introducing my guest to you. To my far right, I got Todd Murray, writer for Dominion Post. He's been with Dominion Post about 20 years. Does a great job of sharing information about Mountaineer sports. We got Gary Tompkins. Tompkins has been with us since last season. And my big man to my left, Big Tone Avery Richardson. Good to have you back, big guy.
Always a pleasure.
As I mentioned, this is our fourth show here at the Green Turtle, and we're really excited to chop it up about what happened this past weekend in Landover, Maryland. Guys, we talked about it last week. Gary, I'll start off with you. BYU coming in, long drive from the West Coast to get here to play Mountaineers. How you think we started off, and how do you think we do?
Well, for starters, I'd like to say that's probably the best first series I've seen the Mountaineers play all season. I think all of our skilled players touched the ball that drive, all except the kill shorts. I mean, we went down the field, we looked real good. I think Skylar Howard looked extremely confident. It looked like he was no longer being a game manager, but actually the general of the team. He looked like he was in full control. It seemed like the game was going the way that he wanted to do it. I think they had a great start.
I thought they mixed some runs in there nicely as well. Justin Crawford, who they kind of felt had done tried to do a little too much against Youngstown State. He bounced back big in that BYU game. And then, you know, Russell Shell didn't gain a lot of yards, but, you know, his yards per carry was like, you know, almost 4 yards a carry, and he did score two touchdowns. And, you know, I thought being able to have some running game really helped as well.
Todd, you know, really it's been running back type by committee for the most part. Really trying, in my opinion, in terms of Shell, Crawford, and Kennedy, all three touched the ball. I thought they all were team contributors that we did well. Tone, one theme that we saw early on last year that we were harped on a lot or we celebrated was the fact we would go down and drive and score during the first drive. And to be able to do that this week against a good BYU team, what do you think about the Mountaineers on the first drive, Tone?
Well, I'm going to go back to what Gary said. That drive that we had was outstanding, and I believe he was 10 for 10 on that drive. So, I mean, I thought that was very outstanding as far as us getting the ball, setting the tone early against a BYU team that had a very good defense. So that was very encouraging to see West Virginia come out the box and ready to play ball.
You know, what's cool about that, you think about, as I said earlier, in terms of BYU, they came and played quality opponents, losing against Utah and you losing against UCLA, to be able to be prepared, first and foremost, we had that week off, to be prepared to be able to play a team that was tested. I thought bode well for the Mountaineers. We seemed ready to go. As I mentioned, we went straight down the field and scored. What do you think about our preparation in terms of a big game like that?
Well, I think that just looking at the way we came out showed that we were prepared. It showed that we were at least had a different focus than we had in the previous game. We didn't come out sluggish. We didn't come out slow. Like I said, we took full control and command of the game, and I'd especially like to see that from Skylar Howard. One of the other things that I noticed was that, I don't know if anybody else took note of this, but I think Javon Durant touched the ball 3 or 4 times that first series, and he's been someone that I think we've been kind of missing. Where has he been this season so far? And he's one of our guys that really helped us and put up numbers. So I think the focus was to kind of actually have this team aspect and this team mentality. We got a bunch of receivers the ball. We're doing this running back by committee, which maybe the running backs, I don't know how they feel about it, but it works for us right now. It seems to be doing well. One of them gets hot, pushes the other. So I'm really impressed with what I saw early on. You know, obviously we'll talk about later and what happened, but I think coming out, I think we had a different focus than we had in weeks past.
Todd, what did you think about in terms of preparation for the team? What was the thought process, or, you know, you being there, were they excited and ready to get it on with BYU?
Yeah, I think they were. I mean, they know this is a team that, although they're on the other side of the country and it's another team they see, but they do see some of their games on TV. They know they're in bowl games just about every year. They're always a physical, well-coached team. And they obviously knew BYU had not given up, I think, more than 20 points in their first three games. Right. So that they knew that it was going to be a challenge to score on this team. And to be able to, you go out there and do that, I think that just boosts the confidence really high, you know, going into this Big 12 opener against Kansas State.
I agree. You know, we said going early on that the third game for us as in the past has been that Maryland-type team, right, or the Maryland game, and we talked about this potentially being a bellwether for West Virginia. And we said if we got past this game with a little more confidence, that would kind of give us some insight onto how we would take on the Big 12. And you know, we were concerned, Gary, about them having a more mature team. They had bigger guys up front. We talked about them being strong and big up front and talented on the receiving. But yet the Mountaineers came out there, as Todd just mentioned, with a whole bunch of confidence, ready to play that game. What do you think about us looking at that team coming in and being prepared for them?
Well, I don't know what happened during the off week. But like I said, we could tell that there was a different approach to this game. Obviously, some of that maturity showed up for BYU in a positive way late in the game. But the way that we handled things, I think we were consistent with the running game. Seemed like Coach Hogerson was doing a good job of mixing up run and pass. Okay. It seems that he became a little bit more aware of what we have on offense, and I think he made us as Mountaineer Nation a little bit more aware of who we have on offense. Because again, he pulled out names that we hadn't seen in a while. There was Javon Durant, right. Wellman touched the ball, Karam White had some touches. Austin, who, I mean, seems to be our big play guy right now, he's one of those guys that's standing out. And when you have a crop of receivers, one of the things that you can never really worry about, most coaches and quarterbacks worry about who's going to be the guy that stands out. The receivers, they sort that out. You know what I mean? The guy starts touching the ball and making plays with the ball, the quarterback starts going to him a little bit more often. I think we're in a good place right now. I think this is a step that we build on, and this next game is going to be one that's, I think, it sort of continues that bellwether for us, you know what I mean, telling us where we're going into the Big 12.
I'm going to go back to what Todd said, that I thought BYU was the type of team that we're going to be seeing in the Big 12, meaning they're going to spread you out, they're going to throw the ball around, and I thought this was a good test to prepare them for what they're going to see here in Big 12 play. So, kudos for them to go out there and get that win over BYU and to get ready for a Big 12 play.
Tone, I was coming right at you because I wanted to hear from you, Tone, in terms of we were talking about that big offensive front.
Yes, sir.
And how difficult it was going for West Virginia to be able to play against a defensive front in terms of BYU's defensive front versus our offensive line. From a lineman perspective, how much confidence you thought the Mountaineers had to be able to push BYU around like we did so we could run the ball a little bit more?
Well, as I said before, you know, I'm a WVU guy, and I like the offensive line. I think they really have some nice size. I think the boys move well, and I think they work well together. BYU was a good test across the board for West Virginia. So we were able to move the ball at times, running game going at times. But I think that's something that we need to work on as the season moves forward. So we're going to see here coming up against Kansas State, and I don't want to get all into that because I'm sure we're going to cover that. But I thought we passed the first test against BYU. We was able to run it. We was able to throw it. So now we got to continue to do that as we get into Big 12 play.
Todd, early on, you know, the games end up heading into the second quarter, 10-7. Mountaineers found themselves behind for the first time against BYU. What was the mood, or were you around? What was the mood in terms of the team when they found themselves behind 10-7 in the first half?
Yeah, it seems obviously this team has not been behind a lot this year, but I don't think you sense any kind of panic or anything on the sideline, which is important. Even though they're playing a lot of young kids on, you know, offense and defense, it seems like, you know, they keep their heads. The coaches, they stay in the game.
Good.
You know, which is so important because a lot of teams just lose it. The games get away from you. And, you know, so far we haven't really seen that from this WVU team. And I think that's going to be big going forward as well.
And that kind of speaks to, you know, you and I often talked about Skylar Howard and his management ability. He was unfazed in terms of when they found themselves behind, they kind of just kept on chopping wood, you know. And that's the kind of Mountaineer mentality we like for our football team. As former players, we know, hey, we always talk about the next play and that being the most important play, the next play that you play when you're on the field. And I thought our Mountaineers responded very well. You know, one thing I was concerned about is, you know, and I – I hate calling out names. Right. You know, we talked about Russell Shell. We want more productivity from Russell Shell. I mean, he's a senior, and I assume he'll get there, but we want to see him get better because going into Big 12 play, we're going to count on Russell Shell as well as the junior college transfer to be able to produce for the Mountaineers. What do you think about Russell moving forward?
I think Russell Shell is, I know that he's a senior, but it still seems like there's times that he's trying to find his way and try to figure out what type of running back he wants to be. I think he understands, or he's been a guy that's, you know, really shifty. He can make some moves, but sometimes he gets stuck in his moves that he's making. He's maybe making a little bit too many moves in the hole instead of just taking that one shot and go and getting downfield. He does that a little bit better than we probably give him credit for. There's been times that I've seen him just hit the hole and go. He's a powerful back. He's got good frame, good size, good strength in him, and he's elusive. But I think that he might feel he's a little bit more elusive than he really is. And if he could just take some time and just hit the hole for us, I think he'll probably see more production. And I think that's kind of what stopped him last year with sharing the ball with Smallwood, who thankfully gave WU a good showing this weekend in NFL.
He looked good.
But I think that Russell Shell right now is kind of going how the team is going. Like you said, we'll get there. I think even with this BYU game, as a team, we are all we'll accept this game. We're 3-0. It looks good. It's something to build on. And I think it's a team that's going to continue to build and progress during the year, just as Russell Shell will.
Okay.
Right.
That makes a lot of sense, Garrett. I'm a Russell Shell guy. You know, I like his hair and stuff like that. But I would like to see more production from this young man. I thought it was going to be a breakout year for him,
right,
JT.
I
know when Smallwood left, went on to the NFL, I thought, okay, he has the backfield to himself. But I like the freshman. that young man, he's hitting that hole. He's getting up in there, and he give you that burst. That's just something that's not taught. And I like the guy Crawford. I mean, he's like one of those guys, you put him on the bus, you want him to get off the bus first because he's a big, powerful young man. So I think our running game is in good shape, but I think we'll be better once we get Russell going.
No doubt in my mind, because we saw this in the first game. Mm-hmm. When Crawford did well, he kind of challenged Shell to step his game up, and he did.
That's right.
Again, I kind of mentioned that because I talk about being on this show, us former players holding our guys accountable, and we know they'll continue to get better. But guys, as we continue to say, BYU was a good game for us. It fell at the right time. Mountaineers overall, I thought, did pretty well.
Absolutely.
I was really concerned defensive-wise, them being so big up front, Tone. I was concerned about our 3-3-5 defense.
Okay.
But for the most part, I thought we did well in our 3-3-5. What do you say?
Well, you remember I text you.
Yeah.
When I text you, what did I say?
I forget.
Well, I text JT during the game, as I do most games. And I was a little concerned with our pass rush. And he knows I'm going to go there. I'm texting JT. I'm saying, God, this guy got a lot of time back there, man.
Right.
We got to make him speed him up a little bit, you know, make him do something that he normally doesn't do. You had mentioned a good point, too, about your son who played under this defense that it takes a long time to learn.
Right.
So I'm going to be a little patient, and I'm gonna hopefully these guys will get to learn this defense. But I would like to see moving forward pass rush. I want to see us get after quarterbacks because in this Big 12, they're going to throw it.
Right.
And we're going to have to be able to go after people's quarterback. What do you think about that, Todd?
Well, it's, you know, playing that 3-3-5 stack, you got three guys up front against their five. It's tough to do. Of course, the linebackers, you know, have to get involved at times, and, you know, even some of the DBs. But, you're right. You got to put pressure on the quarterback to have a chance to win in the Big 12.
And we know the Big 12 are big up front also. Right,
sure.
And most teams in the Big 12, from their defensive front, they won the 4-3 stack type of even front. With this odd front, I just heard complaint after complaint about the guy having too much time. And although we are dropping eight in terms of DBs and linebackers that's supposed to be protecting for the pass, we're not being able to hold them long enough to be able to disrupt any pass. And I worry about that moving into Big 12 play. Specifically this week up against Kansas State. Gary, from a secondary, how long do you need back there in terms of being able to cover a guy?
The least amount of time as possible, because that's what we need. We need a pass rush no matter what happens. I had the fortunate experience of having Canute Curtis, Gary Stills, Henry Slay, John Thornton, people who were going to get some pressure on the quarterback. Absolutely. I watched our old Marshall game the other day and how many times Chad Pennington hit the ground. And so that does us a favor. And actually, this is team defense. Everything, no matter how many times the cornerback or the safety gets an interception, we count on those guys up front, because when they hit us the pass rush, we can get pick off balls.
Right.
If we are back there covering, those guys can get sacks. So we depend on that a lot. The 3-3-5 worries me, and I know that's our defense. I know we've been able to make plays out of that defense, and I'm not going to tell Coach what to do. But I am afraid, not just for the pass, the Big 12 teams don't get enough credit for running the football. And what we saw from BYU, there were plenty of times that they were able to just get under center and line up and go right at us. And let's not forget, their running back, Jamal Williams, had 100 yards the first quarter. That's something that people didn't tend to realize. Our defense is just going to have to do better at getting those numbers down. 500-plus yards in the ball game. You remember, 200 yards passing, 100 yards rushing. That was the goal.
Right.
That is what we set forth in terms of trying to make sure that the mark in terms of if we had a good showing on defense.
Sure.
And right now, we're not having that kind of showing on defense. I'll give them credit. They are getting the turnovers, and especially when they count, that was the thing that saved us. But we're going to have to get those numbers down.
Let me ask you guys a question. Were you guys as surprised as I was that BYU went away from Williams running the ball in the second half when all the success they were having? I mean, it seemed like they did WVU a heck of a favor by doing that.
They panicked. That's all I saw. I feel like they panicked, and they felt like they had to get the ball to what they felt was a mismatch in that 6'5 and 6'6 receiver, and they tried to take advantage of that, and it didn't work out for them.
We were, you know, Jamal Williams, you know, top running back. I mean, I think the guy goes 6'1", 230 pounds. That's a big back.
Nice size back.
And you keep having a guy like that, pound, 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 he's susceptible getting beat with some big runs.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a huge talent. So, you know, it was very surprising to see that BYU didn't stick with him more often. And, again, obviously for us it was a good deal. But, again, it shows some vulnerabilities in our defense. We suspect that they will get better moving forward. But we got a lot of work ahead of us moving into Big 12 play. You know, I'm like as you mentioned, Gary, we had four turnovers.
Yes.
One forced fumble and three interceptions. Mm-hmm. In fact, one of the interceptions gave us an opportunity to win the game. And the young man, the cornerback?
Maurice Fleming.
Maurice Fleming caught the last interception that really sealed the deal for us in that game. So kudos to the secondary for pulling that thing off for us. But we were very, very worried about that, and we're glad they were able to play as a team.
Kudos to the big man, too, because I love to see the big man get the ball. I love to see the big man. I don't care if he get it on a pitch back or if they line him up in the backfield like they used to do Fridge and give him the ball. I like to see the big man, you know, get his hands on the football. So I like to see Wachaku or whatever, however you say his name. I like to see him on that play and get an interception. So that was fun to see.
I'll tell you what, though. I mean, you know, when that – what looked to be a disastrous fumble when they're about to score at the 4-yard line. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, you know, BYU's jumping all over the place. There's 2 minutes and 36 seconds left. I mean, this is a major test for this defense.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Now, they completed some passes. They got downfield, but, you know, ultimately the defense came through to save this game. You know, I think that's huge.
As Coach Gibby said, that's why he called them the Dogs. Defense always win ball games.
That's
what I mean? Defense always win games, right? We're talking about football games. So kudos to the Dogs.
That's right.
you know, guys, let me take this opportunity to do a trivia question. Hopefully you guys were listening up very well. And I want to remind you guys, we are here every Wednesday at 6 p.m. at the Green Turtle Sports Bar and Grill. First up, guys, we're going to give away – let's do this. Let's give away – and I say this all the time – we're going to give away our Noel Devine poster, right? And the trivia question will be this. Make sure you write it down, right? Oh, it's signed. Oh, ha-ha.
Okay.
Not only is this a picture, it is a signed picture by Noel Devine. One of his great runs against Connecticut. So this is the trivia question. To get the mic over to you, all you have to do is raise your hand and we'll get the mic to you. What was the last name of the guy that caught the game-saving touchdown? All right, I'll give you a multiple choice. All right, it will be Tyler. Last name, we're just going for last name. Flemings or Douglas? Tyler, Flemings, or Douglas? We got a hand back there.
You got somebody?
Good deal.
Yeah, is it Fleming?
Flemings, you are absolutely correct. You win this signed autographed picture by Noel Devine. Now, as you know, for all of you that come here every week, there's always two phases to winning stuff here. You have to be able to catch. And I throw you this pass. All you got to do, let's see if you can catch it. There we go. I'm telling you, right now, guys, I am 100%. No, you keep that ball. You keep that. Hey, I am 100% on my passes this year. We're good to go, Coach Hoaxson. And again, right here at the Green Turtle Sports Bar and Grill, we got receivers. We got them all. We have.
You look like an athlete.
Yeah, he's a good-looking athlete. He should be recruited.
He might be able to recruit that young man.
Guys, again, we're going to get back in this thing. We're talking about BYU versus WVU, who just played this past weekend in Landover, Maryland. The score, 35-32. West Virginia brings it home in a exhilarating, fun-filled matchup against BYU. Guys, let's keep moving. One phase of the game, guys, that we always are concerned with, we didn't see a whole bunch of movement this week, special teams.
Man.
Special team. That's one of those sore thumb type of topics that we always get worried on, Gary. What do you think about special teams?
I think special teams has to be a focus now. I think it's got to be one of those things that we focus on coming in maybe on a Monday. We go review the game tape on Saturday, come in on Monday, make it fun. Make special teams fun, tell the special teams unit that if you get a block punt this week, then, you know, maybe we finish practice 10 minutes early. Do something to kind of excite the guys about special teams, because at this point in time, the guys don't seem real excited about it. Seem like we're putting bodies on the field, guys who just want to go out there and say, okay, hopefully somebody else will make a tackle. Hopefully somebody else will block the punt. Hopefully someone else will be able to do something to get us in a good field position. But it doesn't seem like anybody else is really out there saying, I want to do this, and I'm the person that's going to make the plays on special teams. We didn't look real good, and I'm concerned about that going into the Big 12.
Todd, I thought I saw a press conference where Coach Hoaxson was, you know, really adamant about it, potentially putting starters on that special team. What do you think about, what's the conversation about special teams right now?
Yeah, that's exactly what he said. I mean, he's, you know, what, threatening to make some personnel changes there, and he probably has to. I mean, when you think of Kansas State, usually the first thing that comes to most people's minds is special teams.
Right.
They've made their living off that for years, and it's a bad memory for WVU fans when Morgan Burns takes that kickoff back 97 yards in the fourth quarter to put him ahead there last year. Then 2 years ago here at Milan Pushkar Stadium, Tyler Lockett, who was a fantastic return guy. I think he's in the NFL now. He took a punt back 43 yards, so, you know, that helped them pull out that game here. So, you know, they know what's coming, you know, with this Kansas State special teams. And, you know, they've got to get that shored up.
Yeah, absolutely. Tom, what do you say? I mean, you know, guys, you know, let's think about this. Let's talk about this. You know, it's three phases of the game.
Sure.
Offense, defense, and special team. You cannot be lacking one and think about competing either for a bowl game or for a Big 12 championship. You cannot do it without having three sound phases of the game.
Right.
What do you think, Tom?
Right. Well, I always – special teams for special players. And I have no problem with putting on my starters on special teams, because some of these guys are game changers. I would love to see Gibson back there, get him in open space. One thing about special teams, you can get your best athlete in open space. So why not utilize the talent of some of these young men? Is there a risk factor of them getting injured? That's part of the game. You know, any part of the game, that can happen. But special to me, special teams, special players. Virginia Tech was a team that's all they did was special teams. I mean, that's one thing they focused on. They had their starters out there. Yep. You've seen everybody except for Michael Vick.
Right.
He wasn't on special. But everybody else was out there. But I think that's outstanding. I hope we move forward by putting some of our special players on special teams.
And let's talk about that. Let's talk about this, because Tom brought up a great point, right? And people may be concerned about this. Why don't we put starters on special teams, right? You're worried about your first team guy running down the field, getting dinged from the side, or potentially getting a high-risk shot, and you don't want that for yourself. But, Gary, at some point, we got to be able to do something better about special teams.
Special teams are for special guys, but the reason why is not just that your special guys are your best athletes. The special guys are the guys who want to win the most. And that's what happens on special teams. I can remember when I was here, Dave Carter, Chris Edmonds, even a guy by the name of Tyshawn Evans, we would compete to see who would get the punt block. That's what we were trying to do. We were trying to create something on special teams. And when we had a guy in return, we were trying to create something in return. You mentioned the wall a few weeks back.
Right.
We wanted to get to that wall so we can start picking guys off.
Back.
You know? And so what we have to do is you got to find out who are the guys who want to be playmakers. You have to sell special teams as your playmaking, as guys who can make plays on your team. Because that's what it is. It can change the tide. That's one of three. If one part of that hole is missing, then you're talking about you're dealing with about 66%. That's not going to get you anywhere in anything. If you're 66% grade, you're failing. Okay? If you're grading 66% out in your performance at work, you're failing. If you're grading out 66% on the football field, you're failing. And so no matter how many yards your offense put up, no matter what your defense is doing, if your special team isn't a part of that, you're failing.
Right.
And I think that's the problem with but it's an issue for our football team because that's the one place I don't see where we're playing as a unit.
Todd, have we conceded on the punt team in terms of we just want to catch the ball? I mean, that's not a place that we want to be where we concede the punt, right? Again, guys, we're going to get after you because we want to see you do better in this phase of the game. Todd, let's talk to me about that.
Yeah.
What's going on with the punt where we're just – conceding or rather just okay with just catching the ball?
Of course, if you'll remember, a couple of years ago, they decided to go with no punt return.
Right.
Because it was so bad. You've got a kid back there now in Gary Jennings, so I think the coach is like, I like this kid too. He catches the ball. He's he's fearless, sometimes maybe a little
he
too fearless.
Not
signaling for a fair catch, but I think if this kid could get a little – room to maneuver back there, that he could be, you know, something really special as a punt returner. But you know, the number one thing is he catches the ball, and that's the most important thing.
Right.
I think they have the tools there. They, you know, if they can just get it to where, you know, he can have some room to run, I think he can do some good things there.
Right. And guys, again, we're gonna keep talking about this as long as people keep showing up. We're gonna keep talking about special teams, so there ain't no hiding from it.
Well, JT, let me ask you this question.
Yes, sir.
And look through your sheet there. I'm not exactly, you know, penalties. It wasn't that many penalties. Am I right to say that?
No, you're right. You're right.
So I think that's always something I like to keep my eye on because that tells you how disciplined your team is. Mm-hmm. And I think going forward, we haven't received a lot of penalties in the last, you know, in all the games. I don't know what's being highly penalized. So, again, that's kudos to coaching ability of getting those guys to focus and do the right thing because penalties are a big part of the game.
And let's talk about that. That's a great point. Now, I'm going to tell you, being a defensive guy, I may get a penalty every once in a while.
You have to. It's a
must. Not a personal foul, right?
It's a must.
I'm telling you, I want you to be, I may just smack you upside the head every once in a while, you know, just to let you know I'm here and get
that's
you afraid to come across that middle. I mean, but it's a part of the game, Tone. Penalty's a part of the game,
absolutely,
you know.
Absolutely.
It's deficit spending.
Well, you get it live from the player's point of view. That's
what you got to do. Might be my turn one game, might be your turn.
Exactly.
We got to do something.
I mean, you know, so I'll just share it with you my mentality, and this is all subjective, right? So my thought is, look, I want to make the opponent weary about challenging me or challenging my team on defense. So, you know, every minor down, you know, and then talk, you start thinking about a team like that, and, you know, you've heard this phrase before, that's a nasty team or that's a bad team. Hey,
Chippy.
To me, that ain't necessarily a bad thing all the time. You think about Miami. Back when we played, right?
That's right.
You always worried about Miami being a bad team or a tough team or a violent team. That made you play a little different, right?
What do you do when you go into a rough neighborhood? You keep your head on a swivel.
Right.
Okay? That's the same thing when you come in back there in the secondary, you come in playing defense. Guess what? If you think of me as a nasty or a bad team, then you worried about me and you're not worried about
that's
the offensive game plan.
Right.
And that's how I'd rather have you worried about me.
So that speaks to Ty identity, right? Identity in terms of has this defense or have our team taken on any particular identity?
I'm not sure that they have today just because they have so many new kids playing. They lost a bunch of guys to the NFL, right. And they're kind of, you know, in this non-conference schedule, they're kind of filling themselves out. And, you know, they're trying different players in there to try to see, you know, just what kind of defense this is going to be. I think they've learned a lot. Do they have to play better? Yes, especially now with this Big 12 slate, you know, coming up. But, you know, I think the talent is certainly there. A lot of it is young talent. There'll be some more learning and growing that needs to go on. But, you know, I think that, you know, in the next month, you're going to know a lot more about what the right. real identity of this defense is when you hit this Big 12 stretch.
I agree. And for us in Mountaineer fans, you know, Todd makes a great point, right, in terms of this is a young team. They are, you know, some of these guys, their first starts, they really got to find themselves. So that says to me that our Mountaineer fans, as well as us players, maybe need to be as patient. But I'll tell you, up here, we've been doing this for a while. We ain't as patient as
No. No.
But again, we certainly understand. We know what it's like to be out there. We just had a nice graduating class. And now it's time for people to fill shoes. Right? It's time for us to fill shoes.
Stepping up.
Well, you're right. And that'll happen. So let's get moving and talking about a big game that some filling of shoes is going to have to happen real quick, Tone. The next opponent,
yes,
and that'll
sir.
Be Kansas State.
Yes,
Tone,
sir,
we've never beaten Kansas State.
Nope.
What do you think about that?
Well, you know what you're getting with Kansas State. And I think Tompkins and I was talking about, you know, what a well-coached team they are. Coach Snyder does a great job of getting his young man prepared. They're going to punch you in the mouth. They're a physical team. They have one of the better defenses in the country right now. They're 2-1. They played a Stanford team that's in the top 10.
Yeah.
That is a very good team they played. They didn't let that young man McCrafferty run all over the place.
No,
they got like 126 yards. Still a lot of yards. we're going to have to be ready for this contest, JT, because
right.
Kansas State is a very good team. And
they
got our number right now.
Yeah.
I mean, they're 4-0 right now, I guess.
Right.
So
right.
What do we have to do, Gary? What are we going to have to do?
Quick correction. Just a correction. I said we've never beaten them. We never beaten them under Coach Holgorsen.
Oh, okay.
I should say that. But I'll go ahead and defer to Gary. What do we do?
We haven't beat them in our lifetime.
Right?
So
yeah, right.
1936 or somewhere in there, right? So we haven't beat them in our lifetime. You can say the same thing about Kansas State almost every year. They're going to be a well-coached football team. Their coach always prepares them for success. They're going to be great on the special teams.
Yep.
And a lot of what's going to happen with Kansas State is going to come directly through the quarterback. No matter who they put, you know, back there, it always seemed, I think they called the guy a couple years ago Megatron.
That big quarterback.
Right. No matter who they put back there, the offense is going to run through him. He's going to get a lot of yards rushing. He's going to get a lot of yards passing. One of the interesting things to me is that their offense has played three quarterbacks. Even though that third quarterback's only got one or two snaps, they've played three quarterbacks. So, to me, that tells me that they're trying to prepare their team to win. They're trying to prepare their team for the future. And that's a little scary because now you don't know what they're going to do to us or prepare to – what trick play or what new offensive wrinkle they're going to put in to prepare for the Mountaineers. They know they're 4-0 against us, and that's sort of a big brother mentality. I beat you every time I play you,
sure.
Marshall. Okay? That's what happens when they play us. And so they have a little bit of an ego about that. We have to find out what we can do to shut them down and to shut off that ego.
That's right.
Todd, what Bill Snyder has been around this game for a long time, right? He seemed to have found some sort of formula where he has guys out in Manhattan, Kansas. Been there. It's the middle of nowhere, right? Manhattan, Kansas playing football at an elite level,
mm-hmm.
right? These
right.
guys, a couple years ago, you know, talking about potentially competing for a national championship,
right.
you know, if things work out for us.
Right.
What is Bill Snyder doing that's making his football teams so much better?
He just seems to have a knack for finding just these sound fundamental guys that maybe they're not flashy or super five-star recruits, but they know how to play the game, and they know how to play the kind of offense and defense that he does. And it doesn't always take a group of, you know, a lot of times the group of five-star players don't always win national titles.
That's right.
Sometimes it's those, you know, two or three-star guys who are really good at what they do, and they fit in well together. And I think, you know, that's what a lot of way he's molded a lot of his teams. you know, there in Manhattan, and that's why he's got a stadium named after him. And not a lot of living coaches have that honor. Right. So obviously he's done a great job.
Right. You know, he comes in this game, well, this upcoming Saturday, they come in here 2-1, lost against a good Stanford team. Gary, their defense is ranked number one in national college football right now. They're coming into Mountaineer Stadium, ranked number one against our offense, who's ranked number six in the Big 12.
Right.
That means we have a tall task in front of us this upcoming homecoming weekend Saturday. What do you think about that?
One, it's homecoming weekend, so hopefully we can get enough former Mountaineers out to come and support the team, get the guys up feeling as though that, you know, they have something that they want to play for. The other thing is, you know, having a tough defense to play against, usually defense travels. Offense doesn't usually travel as well in terms of production. Defense usually travels because those guys have a certain mentality. We're going to stop you no matter if you're at home or away, you're in our house, whatever, because the defense always feels this is my house. And so that's going to be a tough task for us. I think it's going to be tough to see if Skylar Howard can put together another game like he did last week.
Sure.
I mean, like I said, I think it's one of his better games here as a Mountaineer, period. Forget about yards production. I'm talking about confidence and command of the game. And even the deep passes across the middle, he just looked really good to me last year. I believe one of his better games here.
Okay.
And I think that's what we have to continue to do what we've been doing, using all of our weapons. I would like to see more Javon Durant, more Shell, more Crawford, and just keep mixing that up. And I think that if we can switch that pace back and forth, we may be able to confuse the defense a little.
It's a big game. It's a 3:30 start at Mountaineer Field. The fact that we're playing home, we bring that 12th man, right? So we're excited. Well, hopefully that plays a factor or factors into this ball game.
Mm-hmm.
Also, you got Skylar Harris, second start against Kansas State. As many people talk about, Skylar always playing with a chip on his shoulder. That loss last year, Todd, I assume Skylar Harris coming in this game with a chip on his shoulder, preparing to play against Kansas State. Have you heard from him? Have you heard the thought process of many of the guys preparing for this Kansas State game?
Right. You know, the old chip on the shoulder cliche, we heard that a lot earlier this week talking to a lot of the players. You know, they know the history of this series in the Big 12, and I don't think there's a player who has played, you know, the last couple of years that didn't feel that West Virginia should have won both of those games. They lost a tough one by 6 points here, which, if you'll recall, that was Skylar Howard. That was basically his debut as the WVU's quarterback when Clint Trickett went out with that concussion, and he came in. It looked like the game was over, and he darn near rallied them to win, you know, that year. And I think they felt they had control last year until that, you know, disastrous, kickoff return when Morgan Burns, you know, took it to the house there. So I don't think it's a point of them thinking that they can't beat these guys. They know they can beat these guys. They believe they should have beaten these guys the last couple of years. So, I think that's, you know, that's been big motivation this week. And, I think you'll see that, come out in their play Saturday. I'd be surprised if it doesn't.
You know, but one thing we all know, right, when you have these big games like this, Tom, what we can't do is get overexcited about it, right? We're 3-0 right now. We got to go in this game, obviously knowing that we're behind in terms of the win-loss ratio against this team. They got to go, first of all, with a thought of urgency, but yeah, they got to be calm knowing they're playing in front of the Mountaineer Field at an environment that's conducive to us playing well. What do you think about mentality-wise? These guys got to be thinking going into this game, Tom.
Well, first of all, it's homecoming weekend. So, that's a big weekend for West Virginia, for alumni and fans to come out here and support the Mountaineers. So, I'm sure they'll be excited. And I know, speaking of former players, if you can't get up for that, then you shouldn't be there.
Right.
I mean, that's just what it is. So, but I think the confines of being back in Morgantown for this game will be definitely helpful. It should be a great game for everyone to watch and participate in. I just want the guys to play smart, fast, continue not having these penalties. I think that's a great start because penalties are drive killers. I like to see Skylar Howard continue to grow as a player and West Virginia start identifying who we are on defense. I think we need to find out, because I'm still looking at a roster trying to figure out some of these guys on defense. And I don't know. a lot of these guys are new. So hopefully with their play, you'll start knowing who they are. You know, like I always say, big-time players make big-time plays. So we need some of our big-time players to start making plays.
I agree. We're going to make some plays right now as we take a break. Hey, guys, I want to remind you right now, we're here every Wednesday at 6 p.m. We're at the Green Turtle Sports Bar and Grill. Now, if you don't catch us here, make sure you go check us out at thedominionpost.com. Look on the football section. We'll be right there. At during this time, what we like to do is trivia questions. So, again, I will remind you, to win here, all you had to do was listen to the show. Now, to answer this question, what you have to do is raise your hand. We'll get a mic over to you, and we'll get answered. The question is, in the last 4 or 5 years, what's our record against Kansas State? Raise your hand. We got a hand over there.
Oh and four.
Ah, you're absolutely right. 0-4. We have not beat Kansas State under Hogan scenario. For that, we got some shirts over there for you. Let's show them the shirts. Green Turtle shirts. And let's do this. Let's do this. If you put your hands up, raise your hands, because I like to do this when we do shirts. Raise your hand if you're interested in getting a shirt. For everybody that gets their hands up real quick, 1, 2, 3, 4. We got 4 shirts. That's enough. 4 shirts.
Now they can fit them.
Because of that gentleman asked that trivia question. Again, guys, just want to tell you, to win here, all you have to do is come here every Wednesday at 6 p.m. at the Green Turtle Sports Bar and Grill. Guys, let's get back into it.
Okay.
Let's talk about this Kansas State game. This is a big game coming up during homecoming weekend. You know, guys, I want to scheme it up a little bit. About scheme, right? In this Big 12, you think pass in terms of everybody want to air raid, right. But there's a lot of physical runners in the Big 12.
Yes, there is.
And I think there's no bigger runner than the guy that's coming in this weekend. In terms of, I think they're doing it by committee also, but they're being consistent in their run game. What do you think about in terms of scheme wise, are their run fit versus our 3-3-5, Todd?
Yeah. You don't often you go up against a team where their leading rusher is their quarterback.
Right.
But, you know, in Kansas State's case, that is the case.
Right.
And you know, and they do a good job blocking for him, and you know, and he gets yards, and you know, that's something the WVU defense is planning on working on, you know, this week in practice. So, you know, what they can do to muddle that up, obviously, you know, is going to be key Saturday.
You know, Gary, when we think about a running quarterback, mm-hmm. right, a guy who could potentially run the ball on us. I remember when I played, they used to say, and I'm sure they still use the same terminology, we're going to spy this guy.
Right.
Right? So when we say we're going to spy a guy, typically you have a DB or safety or a linebacker that's conscious of the quarterback leaking out at some point when you have a team that could potentially run the ball down the field on you. Now, what happens with that, we saw this against Oklahoma. When we start doing that zero coverage, going man-to-man, spying these guys, and you're locking on the one guy, then you got a runner busting up the seam on you.
That's
how
right.
How do we maintain that, or how do we contain that, Gary, against the K-State team?
It's going to be difficult. I think Al Rasheed Benton is going to have to be a big player for us this game, just because of the fact I believe he's going to be one of the guys either spying or assigned to the quarterback. I don't think we're going to need to spy him as much, simply because they run the ball, and they run it, you know, straight out of under center, and usually somewhere off the tackle with this quarterback. It's not a whole lot of outside runs. He's going to throw the ball some, I think, to try to keep us honest, but I don't think that's going to be his game. And typically what we've seen from Kansas State over the last few years is them actually, you know, getting the quarterback, having a strong power running game, even with the quarterback. You know, they seem not to care if they spare the quarterback or not. If it's for the better of the team, you're going to have to run the ball. So the 3-3-5, the scheme versus that type of run, I think it leaves us vulnerable, because as you said earlier about BYU, you know, the game may have been different if they'd have just kept running Jamal Williams. And so if they do the same thing with Ertz, or they get a running back who's hot this game, they could potentially just keep feeding the ball to us, hit a couple of passes, and we can find ourselves in a close game.
Running the ball, BYU had nearly 300 yards rushing on us.
Whoa.
Right? That's a lot of rushing yards, right?
That's a lot of rushing yards.
300 yards, because I'm sure that means, Tone, you and I know, in that defensive wow. Locker room this week, there's some conversations that's being had.
A lot of conversations.
Right.
Spirited conversations.
So the guys going into this game knowing that front three, Tone, got to be able to play better against a big front.
Absolutely. And, JT, I'm a little concerned. And I'm concerned because if I go back to the Youngstown game, they had a slippery quarterback, and he moved around a little bit. And this guy is going to move around a lot, too. And he's going to run the game. He's going to run the ball. So my question is, are we going to be able to contain this guy? And that's a concern for me. We're not getting the stops the way we normally got stops in the past. So I'm hoping going to this game we will start to get these stops. It's nothing more demoralizing as a defensive player than a team just constantly running it down your throat. I mean, you're constantly running at you on third and threes, and they're constantly picking first down. You're staying on the field. You're getting tired. So I'm hoping that we get some, three and outs, keep that defense fresh because they're going to ground the pound, and that's what they're going to do. And then maybe a play-action pass, try to get somebody over the top. They used to have a really good receiver there by the name of Lockett, who's playing for the Seattle Seahawks now. I don't know who they got. They always manage to have a player that goes to play on Sunday. So they keep talent, and we might not know who these young men are. But they're a talented program, so they do got big-time Division I players that's going to come here to Mountaineer Field on Saturday, and we're going to have to be up for the task. But we got to stop the run.
And let's face this. We've been relying on 600 yards per game.
Right.
That's been something we've been relying on. Again, I'm going to keep saying this. Go back to the bowl game, win by one. You know, the first two games, we win, but
close.
I don't think in terms of 600-yard production, we win with the margin that we want. And then we just win last week a close game against 600 yards. So if we're relying on that type of offense, if they are able to do what they want to do against our 3-3-5, that means they're taking our offense off the field, which means we're not going to get that production. And if we don't get that production, then things – we may be looking at 0-5 against Kansas State, a position we don't want to be in.
Absolutely.
The benefit, and again, I'm talking about defense because I'm a defensive guy, but offense, we got a lot of weapons that I'm excited about, that I think we're in a better situation now than we were in last year in terms of the number of guys we can spread the ball to now.
Sure.
It's not a matter of just watching Gibson now. You got Durant, you got Shorts, you got other guys that's going to play in the mix. I feel better about our offense being able to be more productive. Stout defense, number one defense, I said, in the country. Worry about that shutting our run game down or minimizing our run game. But I'm excited about our offensive receivers and Howard being able to get the ball to them. Todd, what do you think about that?
Yeah, I think the whole key, and you've heard this word a lot, intermediate.
Right.
Skylar Howard talks about it every week. The receiver's talking about it. You know, hitting those short passes over the middle, breaking one of those. I mean, that's just as good as, you know, as throwing it up deep. It's a lot less risky, to get it to those guys. And, I don't think, Shorts or Durant have egos where, they have to run a post pattern every time. I mean, they're more than happy, to get that ball, and they'll catch it over the middle and go with it from there. And I think that's what made their passing game so much more effective, this year. And, you would hope that would be something they could utilize against Kansas State. If they can do that, I think they can put up some good numbers.
I agree with you. Gary, we talked about last year, we was concerned about the 50-50 balls,
yes.
Right? When we say 50-50 balls, we're talking about where the quarterback, for the most part, is throwing the deep pass, and there's a 50-50 chance of who's coming down with it. So the intermediate kind of helps with that in terms of where we're pocketed or we're identifying we're going to throw short, fast, and early, and we're getting the ball out of his hands. Again, that will help. Another thing I think we're going to be, they run a 4-4, they run a 4-3 defense. Mm-hmm. They're good in the secondary. The thing for us to do, though, and I'm sure you guys, is to spread that defense out a little bit.
Yeah.
If we can spread that defense out a little bit, give us some running lane and some alleys to catch the ball, I think we'll do a lot better.
Right. Okay.
What do you think about that, our offense against a 4-3 defense?
Well, I think our offense has the ability to put up points. I think our offense has the ability to go out there and compete against anyone because we have so many weapons. If things aren't going right, we can go ahead and bring our bring our tight ends in, and we can bring Wellman in, and we can run a power game with Shell. If we want to spread the ball, we can have Shell running it for us some, or we can have Crawford running it for us, or we can have our freshman back there who's not afraid to get physical. Yeah, but we also have, what, five receivers, six receivers? White, Gibson, Shorts, Jennings, Durant. I mean, they all can do something with the ball. So I have the confidence, because if you have that many receivers, what you're going to get is mismatch. And if you get mismatches against a linebacker on one of those guys, then that Kansas State's in trouble. And so if we can get those mismatches and then we can get Skylar Howard to hit those intermediate passes, I think we got a good chance to look good against a good defense, which only goes well for our team and our team confidence.
I agree. You know, and Todd, you know this. That linebacker, Lee, I think he's on all the watch list. Middle linebacker for Kansas State, last name Lee.
Player.
Kid's one of the best in the country. You know, they talk about the kid's ability to run sideline to sideline. We're going to have to stretch him out. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're going to have to find ways to get him off his game and be able to score some points. Again, the advantage, West Virginia for me, obviously we're playing a home game. We're playing in front of our fans. And it's at the, for me, it's the right time.
Yes.
We come off a big win. Mm-hmm. They had a break. I feel like we're good to go. Guys, we're going to get ready to move into our questions from the audience. But before we do that, I want to give some more stuff away. I got a subscription to the Dominion Post. 1 year. How many I got? Two? I got two 1 year subscriptions to Dominion Post. And the question is, here we go, guys. The question is, how many years has Coach Hogerson been here at West Virginia?
Okay.
Good question.
How many years has Coach Hogerson been here at West Virginia?
I heard someone say too long.
Think about that. Think about that. Hey, to answer the question, all you have to do is raise your hand. We'll get the mic over to you.
I think he got an audience stumper.
How many years, Coach Hogerson?
I think we got one over here.
Is it five?
Incorrect. Okay. Incorrect. Close, though. Raise your hand. It's not eight.
Is it six?
What we got? It is.
We have someone
right
here.
Did she say it?
What'd you say?
Six. You're absolutely right, ma'am. You're absolutely right. It's been here
Congratulations.
Six seasons. And you have a subscription to the Dominion Post. I'm going to give the second subscription away for questions answered, questions asked. Again, guys, I want to remind you, we're here every Wednesday at 6 p.m. at the Green Turtle Sports Bar and Grill. So, guys, as I mentioned, we're here to ask your questions. To ask a question, all you have to do is raise your hand. We'll get the mic over to you, and we'll answer to the best of our ability. So I would encourage you to ask the question, and let our panel answer for you. Raise your hand if you got a question. We got a question over here.
Well, I know we've talked a lot about special teams, and I noticed at the end of the last game, which is kind of like throwing up your hands, we started squib kicking it, which frustrates me unbelievably. But how is their returner for Kansas State? Is he a high power returner, or is this something we're going to be squib kicking to again?
Okay.
Or are we going to start playing football and kick it to him and say, beat us?
Tone, I'll let you start with Tone.
Well, you know what? I'm not going to sit up here and tell you, because I don't know exactly what the game plan is going to be. I'm like you. I like for us to kick to that young man and see what he has, to test my team, to go after him. I think sometimes in our kicking game with Billy Kenny, who's the punter, you know, when we're doing this swift kick and stuff like that, you're kind of telling your guys that you can't tackle him. And I don't think that's a good message you want to send to your team. You know what I mean? I'm going to go after you. You know what I mean? You know, unless you're Devin Hester or somebody back there. Hey, I'm punting Devin Hester too.
Thank you.
That's just my MO.
And that's the thought that I was thinking to you. You know, you sit up here, and I know you too, Gary.
Right.
When you squib a quicker ball, you know, we don't want a squib kick.
No,
you know,
we want
somebody to feel confident enough for us to go down there and stop the run. But at the same time, Todd, you know this. It's about winning ball games.
That's right.
You know,
we haven't brought up the fact that Josh Lambert is eligible for this game. He was suspended for the first three games. And I think Coach Hogerson kind of hinted that there might be a good chance you will see him kicking off this week, because they want to flat out, they want to put the ball in the end zone. They do not want their guy. Byron Pringle is his name. He's averaging 26.7 yards per return. So they would prefer to kick it out of the end zone and not give this kid a chance. And I think that, you know, Mike Molina has been pretty solid for the most part. Was not. He had a tough day against BYU on those kickoffs. So I wouldn't be surprised to see Josh Lambert in there handling those kickoffs.
Good point. What you got, Gary?
I'm not a fan of kicking the ball, squibbing it, or doing anything that's going to say, I believe you're going to beat me if we do this. You know, I was always a person that felt like, even if our players said, hey, you know, I think they're better than that team, I hate it when coaches or other players said, why'd you say that? Because that's what I feel. That's what I think. That's the truth. If I go into that game in any way as a ball player feeling as though that I am vulnerable or weak against this team, then you have a better chance of beating me. When you look at a Kansas State team, especially under Coach Snyder, what you're going to see consistently is a good defense.
Sure.
You're going to have a good returner in the special teams game, and you're going to have at least one dynamite person on offense, either a very good running back or a very good receiver. I don't care who's back there returning for them. Honestly, I just want to see us either putting it in the end zone or going ahead and challenging our team and saying, go ahead, kick the ball to this guy, and go make a play.
Good point. Quickly, this is for the one-year subscription. If you would, pull a name out of the basket, and they ask a question, they'll get the one-year subscription.
Steve Smith.
listen. This guy, I'm telling you why we're laughing. We've been here for the last 3 weeks, and we've randomly drawn out of that same turtle. And Steve Smith has won it three times in a row. And we've had three different people pull it out of the hat. So, Steve, you'll get this one-year subscription. Go play the lottery. Now, you got a question for us, Steve?
A question for you?
Yes, sir.
Put him on
you
the spot.
You got to ask the question to win the description. That put a little
I
more
pressure. I had to answer a question.
Yeah, we did all right.
Okay.
Wow, this is incredible.
Okay.
3 weeks in a row. Wow.
Man, that's awesome. All right.
What was the score of last year's bowl game?
I don't know. Shit.
What was it?
43-42
is 1-point game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We had one more than they did.
That's right. About
summing up. 43-42. That's right.
Hey, but listen, now Steve, you know the deal. Now what's your record, Steve? Okay. Here we go. He's consistent. He's consistent. And he does the Heisman. Hey, but that's how you get rewarded, guys. As I just mentioned, Steve's been here week to every week. And 3 weeks in a row, random people has drawn his name out of that. Hey, let's make sure his name ain't on all of those. Guys, before we get going, though, I want to give you one more person a chance to ask the question before we leave. We got a question, yes. Yell it out, you're a big guy.
What are a few more ways you think we could start getting more pressure on the opposing quarterbacks?
Good point, that was a good question. His question was, what are other ways that we think we can get pressure on the quarterback? Good point, let's start off with Todd on this one.
Yeah, like I mentioned earlier, you know, possibly you need to get, possibly the linebackers involved a little bit more in that, and and even some of the DBs.
Linebackers and DBs.
At times.
Okay.
In third down situations, I think it'd be a good idea, just like other teams bringing nickel and dime defenses, to bring in a fourth or a fifth lineman.
What you got, Tom?
I like to see some more stunt. I mean, some more line play where we, you know, we're doing different X's and crosses with our tackles and ends to generate a pass for us before we start bringing our linebackers.
Good point. I agree with all those answers. More linemen, third down, and more stunting. Guys, I want to remind you, although next week is a bye week, we'll be right here at the Green Turtle Sports Bar and Grill, October 5th, I believe. Yes. Now, that week, we're going to throw something different at you. We got some high schoolers coming in. Jordan Page and Isaiah Utt. And also, we'll be having Pat White. He should be here next week. So make sure you stop in. Guys, I want to remind you, every Wednesday, 6 p.m., right here at the Green Turtle Sports Bar and Grill. Guys, until next time, huddle up.